Okay, good morning everyone. So I uploaded selected solution to the first homework. So you can read that from the homework webpage. And today I'm going to upload selected solutions to the second problem, and you will see third homework today. Yeah, I kind of skimmed your solutions, so I couldn't read all the details, but I at least saw your solutions, and I left a very few comments. So if I did, I checked in the first page of your homework. So if you have some mark, then that means you have some comments in the corresponding problem. So if you have that, then please read that. All right. And by the way, so the self-evaluation point would be either 3, 2, or 1, not 0. So even if you didn't do anything, you can put 1 for that, so that you don't get, so you get at least non-zero point for each problem, okay? Any question about homework? If you don't have any marks, that means you don't have any comments in your homework. if you have one, then I checked in the first page, so you can check that out. All right, so let's begin today's lecture. So we are going to talk about it's section 2.3, recursive formulas. Okay, I think at least you can see this part. So, recursive formulas. All right. Formulas for first plane partition, number of plane partitions. So last time we found a recursive formula for the number of partitions, P of n, using Euler's pentagonal number theorem. That gives us a recursive formula for this. Then we want to find a recursive formula for PP of n. So this is what I said. Recall Euler's pentagonal number theorem gives a recursive formula, recurrence formula, formula for P of n, okay, using this generating function, 1 minus q to the I, right? Then because partition generating function is the inverse of this, so we were able to find the recursive formula. But for plane partition, we have generating function for plane partitions, q to the n, n greater than or equal to 0, equals, we have similar formula, I from 1, 1 minus q to the I, to the I. So if we can find, so let's say this is the equation star, if, but unfortunately, there is no known formula. For this, no nice simple formula for this. If we had something like this, if we have a simple formula for this, we can use it to find a recurrence relation for this. But we don't have this, so we will take a different approach. So instead of finding a generating function for this, we will do something else. So we will use derivatives of generating function or formal power series. So d dq of a product of formal power series like this. Let's say j from 1. Then by the product rule, we select one of these factors, and then we take the derivative of that, and then we take the sum over all of them. So k is from 1. We take one factor of this, and then we take the derivative of that. Then that will be f k prime of q. And let's divide this by this, just to have, because then we can have this. Okay, so this will cancel one factor here, f sub k. So that, if you think about that, then this is the product formula, basically. Product formula for the derivative of a product. And then, because this is a constant with respect to k, basically, we don't even need, we can think of this as a constant product of two things. All right? And here, in this equation, we have a product of many factors. So we can apply this to this equation star. So if f sub k, this part, equals here, so 1 minus q to the k raised to minus k, this vector, then let's compute this. Fk prime over fk is equal to, this is just computation, so if you do this, you will get this. That's a simple computation. So we know what this is. So, differentiating both sides of star, we get this. So here, you take the derivative term by term, so n times p, p, n, q to the n minus 1 for the left-hand side, derivative of the left-hand side. And derivative of the right-hand side, we can use this fact. And this will be summation k from 1. Now, we know this part is equal to this, k squared q k minus 1 minus q to the k. And what is this? Let me write this, just j from 1. This part is this thing. But we know what this is. This is the generating function for the plane partition, number of plane partitions. All right? So because we have minus 1 here, let's multiply a q. Let's multiply both sides by q. Then we will get this thing. P of n, q to the n equals k squared q to the k over 1 minus q to the k. And this part, let's rewrite this using just this, because we know there is P of n, q to the n. All right? So we obtain some kind of equation involving P of n. So using this, you can obtain a generating recurrence relation. Oh, by the way, let's rewrite this in a slightly different way. Okay, let's look at this part. We will we are going to rewrite this equation a little bit. The next page. Okay. Next. So, summation k from 1 k squared. This was the formal power series that I mentioned previous page. Now I'm going to expand this denominator using geometric series. Then summation k from 1 q to k squared q to the k, and summation say let's say j from 0 minus q to the k j, right? I just expand it. No, no. Not minus j. Just q to the k times j, right? I just expanded this using geometric series. And then, if I change the order of this summation, j from 0, summation k from 1, k squared, I can combine these two together, q to the k times j plus 1. Just a simple computation. And then now, let's say, let's say t equals this part, k times, let's introduce another variable, t, and then instead of j, we are going to use t. Then what happens is, I'm using different notation in my notes, so I'm a little confused. But okay, all right. T. So if t equals k times j plus 1, what is the range for t? It can be 1. Right, because j is from 0, k is from 1, so this will be from 1, right? And this part, you can replace this by t, and then summation, what is k squared? What is k here? If t is given, k is a divisor of t. So for all t that divides, all k that divides t, we are going to add k squared. Is this okay? I just rewrote this. So we fixed this to be t, and t is from 1. And then once this is fixed, we have to add for all k, but k has to be a divisor of this thing. And for k will appear only as a divisor. So this is another way of writing this. They are the same. Is it okay? Now this thing, this is one frequently occurred sum, which is usually denoted by sigma 2 of t. So here, notation, sigma 2 of n is basically the sum of squares of the divisors. So all divisors of n, we add k squared. 2 means we square this divisor. Then this part is equal to summation t from 1 q to the t sigma 2 of t. Okay? So we rewrote this part over here. Then we obtain this proposition. So because this part is equal to this, using this equation, the left-hand side, we write the left hand side just the same. Q to the n is equal to, now we need this. T from 1, Q to the t, sigma 2 of t, and then this was the generating function for the plane partition. Alright? Any question so far? So equivalently, we can, this part, if you multiply these two generating functions, oh, by the way, let's write in an opposite way, they're the same, because, yeah, this is the number and this is q to the variable, power of variable, so this is usual way. So we have two generating functions, or two formal power series. If you multiply them, we will obtain this, n times p, p of n. So the coefficient of q to the n is n times pp of n. And here, what we get is summation t is from, say, 1 to n. So if you take this part, then you have to obtain, you have to take q to the n minus t in order to get q to the n. So sigma 2 of t times pp of n minus t. All right? So these two are equivalent. They are the same. They mean the same thing. And this is actually, this gives us a recurrence relation for pp of 2. Do you see that? Because pp of n can be computed using pp of something which are less than n, always. Because t is from 1 to n. This is always, these numbers are always less than n. So we, this gives us generate recurrence relation. So let's try to compute some something using this. Pp of, we know that this is 1. Pp 1 equals 1. Pp 2 equals 3. And let's compute pp of 3 using this recurrence relation. So n equals, let's plug in n equals 3. Then we get 3 times pp of 3 is equal to, when t equals 1, sigma t of 1, pp of 2 plus sigma 2 of 2, pp of 1 plus sigma 2 of 3, pp of 0, right? Now you can compute all of this. What is this? Divisor, there's only one divisor of 1, so this is 1 squared, times pp of 2 equals 3, plus divisor of 2. There are two divisors of 2, 1 and 2, times pp of 1, which is 1, plus divisor of 3. There are two divisors of 3, times pp of 0, 1. So this is equal to 3 plus 5 plus 9, which is 18. So if you divide this by 3, then we get pp of 3 equals 6. All right? This way you can compute pp of 4, pp of 5, etc. If you have time, you can just compute this. Yeah. In one of the homework problems, you will be asked to write a Sage code to compute pp of n using this recurrence relation. All right. Any question? Yeah, you may think this is not a very nice recurrence relation because we have to compute n terms or this together with this. It takes quite a bit of time, but pp of n itself is a complicated object, so if you don't have this kind, this recurrence relation, it will be more difficult to compute that. So this is a useful thing. All right. Now we want to count ASM, alternating sign matrices, using recurrence relation. We will find a recurrence relation for ASM. To do that, we have some 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. We will have some correspondence. So we are going to change ASM into another combinatorial object. So this is an alternating sign matrix. Now I'm going to make another matrix, same size. So write the first row the same way. And for the second row, the thing is, okay, just look at, if you want to get the second row, just look at the first and the second rows here, and then you compute the column sums for the first two rows. So the column sum, meaning the sum of these two, is 0. Sum of these two, 1. Sum of these two, 1. 0, 0. So here, again, you compute the number of entries in this column from the first row to the third row. So 1, 0, 0 is 1. Minus 1, 0, 1. 0. 1. 0, 1. Like so. So 1. 1 minus 1, 1, so 1, minus 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, and here is always going to be 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, because the column sum is always 1. So if this is alternating sign matrix A and B, the correspondence is, to write this more precisely, ith row of B here, ith row, is going to be the sum of rows 1, 2, dot, 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 I in A. So you take the row sums of these first I rows, and then you obtain the ith row here. Okay? And from this, you can recover this very easily. All right? Is this okay? Matrix B, clear? And now we are going to construct another object from here, let's say C. I'm going to construct another object C, which is a triangular array of numbers which record the position of ones in each row. So we have one in the first row, in the second position. Okay? So two. For this one. Here we have two ones in the second row in position 2 and 3. So 2, 3 right that way. And we have three ones in position 1, 3, and 5. So 1, 3, and 5. 1, 2, 4, and 5. 1, 2, 4, 5, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Like that. Right. So from alternating sign matrix, I constructed another matrix consisting of the row sums, and then I constructed another combinatorial object, a triangular array, which records the non-zero entries here. This is called a monotone triangle. So definition of let me use the next page. Any question about this construction, by the way? So let me define precisely what this object is. So definition is called a monotone triangle. Monotone triangle of size n is a triangular array. Triangular array aij, where 1 less than j less than equal to I less than equal to n of integers from the set of integers 1 through n, such that it must satisfy these two conditions, aij less than aij plus 1 for ij. Aij less than or equal to ai minus 1 j less than or equal to aij plus 1. It's the same ij pair. So in the triangular array, so this ij means is the number in the ith row in this way, and jth column, or yeah, jth column if you consider columns this way. So if this, we have these three numbers in this triangular array, these two inequality can be expressed in this way. So this is smaller than this, or less than or equal to this. This is less than or equal to this. Like that. And for this, we must have a strict inequality. So triangular array like A11, A12, A21, A22, A31, A32, it's like that. But we must have this condition. These are all strict and like that. So something like that. Okay? Triangular array satisfying these inequalities is called a monotone triangle. So the previous construction from alternating sign matrix, the matrix of the row sums, and then we constructed monotone triangle, this is in fact a bijection. And that is not difficult to see. The above map, I mean this map, from here to here, the above map is a bijection from the set of ASMs of size n to the set of monotone triangle of size n. This is indeed a bijection. From the any monotone triangle, you can construct alternating sign matrix. Do you see why? Yeah, you can go back from here. It's very easy to go back from C to B, right? You can, because this tells you where the ones are. And from this, you can get this. And from the second row, you know what these entries are. So quite easy. So it's bijection. So, corollary, very simple corollary, AN, the number of alternating sign matrices, is equal to, of course, number of monotone triangle of size N. They have the same cardinalities because of this bijection. So instead of finding the number of alternating sign matrices, you can find the number of monotone triangles. Okay, so our goal today of this, so I told you, we want to find a recurrence relation for the number of alternating sign matrices, meaning this. We want to find a recurrence relation for this. So we will use this fact. We will find the recurrence relation for this using this fact. In order to do that, we will define a more refined definition of this. We need a more refined version of this object. So let me define a generalization of monotone triangle. So an AK monotone trapezoid is an arrangement obtained from the last k rows of a monotone triangle of size n. So this example will make this definition clear. 6-3 monotone trapezoid is something like this. One, two, three, four, five, six. So you can see from here, we have a monotone triangle like this, which looks like this, and then we just truncate by taking just the last three rows of a monotone triangle. So this is an example of 6,3 monotone trapezoid. All right. So, simple fact, NN monotone trapezoid, what is that? Monotone trapezoid. What is an N, N monotone trapezoid? Yeah, it's just the original monotone triangle. This is going to be monotone triangle of size N, right? Because you take all the rows, all the N rows, so it is just the original monotone triangle. So this is the same. So when K equals N, we get monotone triangle. And when K is smaller than N, we get something different. So this is a generalization of a monotone triangle. And what about the another extreme, 1,N monotone trapezoid? What is that? Yeah, so we have the last row only. And the last row is always 1, 2, 3 up to N. Why? Because these entries are taken from 1 to up to N. They have to be all in strictly increasing order. So it has to be 1, 2, 3 up to N. There is no other choice. So this is fixed. There is only one N,1 monotone trapezoid. So if we have some kind of, so in between, we don't know yet. But if we have some kind of recurrence relation between them, when K varies, then we may be able to get a recurrence relation for this. So that's the idea. So the goal is find a recurrence relation for the number of N,K monotone trapezoid. So if we have somehow, if we are able to express this using a lower term, N,K, when K is smaller, all the way up to this, then we can get a recurrence, we can obtain a formula for this, recurrence relation formula. That's the idea. Everybody okay? So let's define one term, one notation. Let S be a set A1 dot 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 AN, AK subset of N. So the basic idea is to fix the first row of your monotone trapezoid. MTN of S is number of n plus 1 minus k. So if this is the first row, then we must have n plus 1 minus k rows in this monotone trapezoid. So this monotone trapezoid, number of monotone trapezoids with top row S. Top row is the element in S in weakly increasing order, strictly increasing order. Okay? Then what's this? M, T, N of J, which means just M, T, N with one element J. This means the top row has only one element. So it's going to be n comma n monotone trapezoid, which is a monotone triangle. So what can you say about this? This is the number of monotone triangles with, so in monotone triangle, or okay, yeah, the top, we have only one element in the first row, and that is equal to J. So we want to count that. And this is the number of monotone triangles with J in the top, in the first row. Right? Then what is AN? The number of alternating sign matrices, or number of monotone triangles. Can you write this using one of the things over here? Summation J from 1 to N MTN of J, right? Because monotone triangle always has the top row, which has only one element, that must be one of these numbers, 1, 2, 3, up to N. So this is just immediate consequence of these definitions. Okay, so the question is, I think the question is related to this proposition. So the question was, if we want to have this equation, we must have only one in every alternating sign matrix, right? But that is true. Every alternating sign matrix, yeah, actually I didn't explain the full details of this bijection, but if you start with an alternating sign matrix and do this process, you always get this triangular array. That means we have only one in the first row. If you think about this a little bit, that you can get this conclusion. Can we have another one? Suppose you have another one, that means we must have minus one in between. If you have minus one, this cannot be a row, a column with some column sum 1, right? If you want to have a column sum 1, the first non-zero entry must be 1, not minus 1. So we cannot have this. So in every alternating sign matrix, the first row has exactly one non-zero entry, which is 1. So that's why we get just one in each. In fact, here you can show that ith row has exactly i ones. This is the only way we can get this triangular array. You need to think a little bit about this, but this is a fact that you can check. Okay, so check. Check this. I mean this. Yeah, maybe I should add this to the homework set 3. Show that this is indeed a bijection. Yeah. Thanks for the question, Kyung-sung. Any other question? Yeah, this is not 100%, I think, trivial. It's not difficult, but not trivial either. So you have to think a little bit about this, but not that difficult. So I think this is a good homework problem. So think about it. But it is true, and we indeed get a triangular array like this. And because this is either 1, 2, dot, 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 n, one of them, if you add these n terms, you get alternating sign matrix, number of alternating sign matrices. All right. So because of this, if you can find this for every j, we will be able to compute this one. So that's the idea. And in fact, it's quite simple to get this. In general, we have a1, a2, dot, 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 ak. This can be written as a sum of this. Let me write this, which is quite bk plus 1, b1, a1, b2, a2. So a's and b's are interlaced like this. And b's are in strictly increasing order. Sum over all k plus 1 tuples of b's, integers, we add this. In fact, this is quite a trivial equation because, you know, here we want to compute monotone trapezoid with top row given by this. So we want to have something like this. So left-hand side counts this kind of monotone trapezoid. But if you think about the next row, let's say the next row is B1 given by B2, B3, bk plus 1, right? In order for this to be the next, the adjacent two rows, we must have this relation. And for every monotone trapezoid, we must, if you look at the second row, it will be one of these. So this is equal to this. So this is quite, this implies that. So, in other words, to compute this number, you just divide this monotone trapezoid into several classes according to the second row in your trapezoid. All right? And indeed, this is the recurrence relation that we are looking for. This is it. Looks quite complicated, but it works. Let's see an example. It's going to be very, very complicated to compute alternating sign matrices using this recurrence relation by hand, but if you use computer, yeah, it'll do it for you quickly. So for instance, this, I'm just omitting this curly brace. So think about the next row. What are the possibilities for the next row? It can be either 1, 3, 2, 1, 3, 5. This has to be always 1. And what about this? 5. It has to be 5. And here we have to decide these two. And this can be, this cannot be 1 because it has to be bigger than 1. So it's either 2 or 3. And here it's either 3 or 4. Right? So it's 1. If this is 2, and it can be 3 or 4. Or MT5. 1, 2, 4, 5, MT5. I mean, if you choose 3, you cannot choose 3. So here it should be 4, M1, 3, 4, 5. And now, what is this? The next, so we use this again. What are the possibilities for the next row? It has to be just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Because the last is the last row. Same for this, so we multiply 3. And what is the cardinality of this? 1, only one thing, so 3. So we obtain that this is equal to 3. So like this, for any given sequence of integers, you can compute this. It has many, many steps to compute this. So we want to compute actually 1. But you can do this if you have enough time. Do you have enough time? If you don't, fortunately, a computer can do it for you. So this is another homework problem, to compute this using this recurrence relation. So although it has many, many terms, a computer can compute this. And so these three people, Mills, Robbins, Ramsey, they computed this alternate number of an up to n equals 20 using this recurrence relation. So it can be used. If you have 20 numbers, which are very large, it was enough for them to get patterns, and they conjectured this ASM. Then now we are going to move on to the next section. It's about determinant. So in this semester, we will compute determinants many times. In general, computing a determinant is not an easy problem. Sometimes it's very difficult, so we are going to use many several tools. But before computing determinant, we first need to define what determinants are. We already know this from linear algebra, but I'm going to define this again. So first, let's talk about permutations a little more. Cycles of permutations. Definition. Let's take one permutation, Sn. And a cycle of a permutation pi is a sequence. A1 dot dot dot, say AL, sequence of distinct integers or elements such that AI plus 1 equals pi of AI for I1 dot 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 L minus 1 and A1 equals pi of AL. So this is the definition. That means So pi is a permutation, that means it's a function, one-to-one function, one-to-one, one-to-one function from n to n. And so it sends one integer to another. So basically cycle means this element gets sent to the next element here by pi, and this element will be sent to the next element, etc. And this element will be sent back to this element. That's what cycle means. And because we only care about which element goes to which element, it doesn't really matter what is the first element of this cycle. So we will consider them identical if we obtain one cycle from the other by doing cyclic shift. So we consider any cyclic shift of a cycle as the same one. In other words, A1 dot 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 AN is equal to A2 dot 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 AN comma A1. They are considered to be the same cycle because they send the same element as a function. They send each element to the same thing. Let me give you an example. Permutation pi is written in a two-line notation. So 5, 1, 6, 3, 2, 8, 7, 4, 10, 9. So we have a permutation given in this way. Then 1 is sent to 5, right? So let me draw this as a diagram like this. 1 goes to 5. And 5 goes to 2. So 5 goes to 2, 2 goes to 1, like this. And 3 goes to 6, 6 goes to 8, 8 goes to 4, 4 goes to 3. And the next 7 goes to itself, so like that. And 9 goes to 10, 10 goes to 9. So we can represent a permutation like this diagram. So in this case, pi has how many cycles? 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 cycles. So to write, we can write 1, 5, 2. Sometimes we put commas or sometimes not, so I'm going to use commas and sometimes not. So 3, 6, 8, 4, 7, 9, 10. So there are 1, 2, 3, 4 cycles of pi. And by the way, I just defined cycle this way, just a cyclic array of numbers, distinct numbers. But we can think of a cycle as a permutation. So we can consider a cycle, say C, A1 dot 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 AK as a permutation. How? A permutation is a one-to-one function, one-to-one, one-to-one function. So it sends one element to another. So if you can define C of I for every integer I from 1 up to n, they can be considered as a permutation, provided that as a one-to-one function. If I is in this, okay. Let's do this first. AI equals AI plus 1. And if I is not there, C of, say, J equals J if j is not in this, right? Then it'll be a permutation. For instance, let's consider this. This is a permutation. This cycle considered as a permutation. It will send 3 to 6, 6 to 8, 8 to 4, 4 to 3, and it will send 2 to 2, 5 to 5, 7 to 7, etc. So it is a permutation if you consider that way. Is this okay? In this way, let me use this. In this way, pi can be written as a product of its cycles. 1, 5, 2 times 3, 6, 8, 4 times 7 times 9, 10. Right? So this is a permutation multiplied by another permutation multiplied by another, like that. This is indeed the same as permutation pi. They are a disjoint cycle, we say. They are disjoint cycle. They don't have anything in common in their inside their parentheses. Any question? Is this fine? Permutation as a product of cycles. And you can easily see that the order of these cycles doesn't really matter. If you change the order, you will get the same thing, same permutation. For instance, if I switch the order of these two cycles, it won't change anything to your permutation. Is everyone okay with this? If you want to check whether these are the same permutation, what can you do? Take one element and see which element this element gets sent to. So for instance, let's think about 3. Permutation pi will send 3 to what? Right? It will send 3 to 6. And let's think about this. This permutation sends 3 to what? 3 to 3. This will send 3 to 3. This will send 3 to 6. This will send now, we have to think about 6. 6, it will send 6 to 6. So again, this whole thing sends 3 to 6. Pi sends 3 to 6. In this way, you can check everything. They are the same thing. And because they don't have anything in common, the order of their product doesn't really matter. They will give you the same thing. It means there are many ways to write permutation as a product of cycles. So maybe if you fix some order by giving some priority, then we can write permutation as a product of cycles in a unique way. So let's fix such an order. Oh, and by the way, sometimes when we write permutation as a product of cycles, we sometimes omit these cycles of length 1, having only one element, because it doesn't change anything. But in this case, because we want to write every number appearing once, we will write 7 together. So, note that there are different ways to write permutation as a cycle, like I said. So if we list cycles such that the largest element is the first element in each cycle. Because even for each cycle, there are several different ways to write this as a sequence of numbers. The last element occurs in the first place, and the largest elements are in increasing order. If you write permutation as a product of cycle this way, satisfying these two conditions, then it is called the cycle notation of pi. So we learned two notations of permutation, one line notation, two line notation. Now it's another way of writing a permutation called cycle notation. And in fact, there are several ways to define cycle notation. If you don't like this, you can change this to be like the smallest element of first or smallest element in increasing way, something like that. But let me fix this way. This example. In the previous example, we have this 5, 2, 1, 7, 8, 4, 3, 6, 10, 9. This is the unique way, the only way to write pi as a product of permutations, cycles, satisfying these two conditions. Right? So in each cycle, the largest element occurs in the first place, 7, 8, 10. And these largest elements are in increasing order, right? 7, 5, 7, 10, 8, 10. So you can see this is the only way to write a permutation this way. So this is a cycle notation. Okay, and now I'm going to define the sign of a permutation. Let's use the next page. Different, slightly different topic. So now I'm going to define the sign of a permutation. Definition: a transposition is a cycle of length 2. A cycle of length k means in your cycle there are k elements. So in your cycle there is only two elements, like this, I comma j. So for instance, if tau is a transposition I comma j, and because this is a cycle, we can think of this as a permutation. So what does pi tau do? Tau sends I to j. It sends j to I, and what about the other elements? It will send the remaining elements fixed to themselves. So this is transposition. So transposition is a special kind of cycle. So the sign now, the definition of a sign. The sign of a permutation pi is minus 1 to the m, where m is, here, if pi can be written as a product of m transpositions. If you can write pi as a product of m transpositions, then the sign of this permutation is defined to be equal to minus 1 to the m. So example, pi 1, 3, 2 in one line notation. If you write this as a cycle notation, it's going to be 2, 3. Just cycle, as a cycle, not cycle notation. So it is a product of one transposition. Right? So we wrote this as a product of one transposition. So the sign of permutation is minus 1. And if pi equals 2, 3, 1, then this is a product of two cycles like this. So the sign is plus 1. The sign is always plus 1 or minus 1. just from this definition, it is not clear that this is well defined. So, and that is a proposition. Sign of a permutation is well defined. Proof is left as a homework problem. So in order to show that this definition is well defined, you need to check two things. First, you can always write permutation as a product of transpositions. What if you don't, you cannot, there is no possibility to write pi as a product of transpositions, then you cannot define the sign. So first you need to check that. Any permutation can be written as a product of transpositions. And there can be many different ways of writing pi as a product of transpositions, but they all give the same thing, same number, two, minus 1 to the m. Even though you can write this as a different product of different number of transpositions, they will have the same parity so that you get minus, if you compute minus 1 to the m, you will get the same number. That's what you need to check. And there are actually several different ways to define this sign of a permutation. I'm going to do that. Definition. So CYC is the number of cycles of pi. I mean, in cycle notation, I think. So example. Here, if pi equals 1, 3, 2, what is CYC of 2? Number of cycles of pi. It's not 1, but it's 2. Because here we have another cycle. In cycle notation, we must have all numbers. Every number must appear exactly once. This is going to be 2. And 2, 3, 1. Cycle of 2, what is cycle of 2? Cycle of pi. We wrote this as a product of 2 cycles, so is it 2? No, this is not a cycle notation. So if you write this as a cycle notation, actually it sends 1 to 2, 2 to 3, so it's like that. So it's going to be 1. In cycle notation, so disjoint cycle, including one cycles. In cycle notation, that's what you mean. Okay. And proposition. For a permutation pi Sn, sine of pi is equal to minus 1 to the n minus cycle, number of cycles of pi. So this can be an alternative definition or equivalent definition to this. So they are the same. They give you the same number. So this is, you can consider this as a definition. They are equivalent. Again, this is a homework problem to show that they are the same. Question? One more definition, equivalent definition, I mean. Pi is a permutation in Sn, and a pair I comma j, pair of integers, 1 less than or equal to I less than j less than or equal to jn, a pair of integers is called an inversion of pi if pi of I is greater than pi of j. So their orders are reversed. ij, I is smaller than j, but pi of I is bigger than pi of j. In that case, we call the pair I comma j an inversion of pi. And I and v of pi is the number of inversions. And also, in the textbook, capital I of pi is the number of inversions. They are the same. So sometimes I will write this, or sometimes this. They mean the same thing, okay? In the textbook, this one is used because this is also common way to write the number of inversions. So I'm going to use both. Example. So 1, 3, 2. Oh yeah. By the way, you can check that these two give the same numbers, but for these two permutations. So what is the sign of this using this definition? Minus 1 to the number 3 minus 2, which is minus 1, right? And here, minus 1 to the 3 minus 1 is 1. So they give the same thing. And this is third so what is the number of inversion here? 1, 2, they are in the regular in their usual order. 1, 2 is fine. 1, 3, that's fine. 2, 3 are in the reversed order. So 2, 3, we have only one inversion. And if pi equals 2, 3, 1, 1, 2 are reversed. So 1, 2 is an inversion. 1, 3 is also an inversion. 2, 3 are OK. So we have is 1. I of pi in this case, 2. So proposition for a permutation pi in Sn, sine is always equal to minus 1 to the number of inversions. So here, if you compute I minus 1 to the I, we get minus 1. Here, we get plus 1. So they are the same as before. Again, this is the proof of this is left as an exercise. Okay, we will take a 5-minute break.